This video was brought to you by GeneralPack.com, making power systems intuitive, open, and free to everyone, everywhere. Consider subscribing and supporting through patreon.com/GeneralPack. This is the mechanism for you to support us financially so we can continue making high-quality power system video tutorials. Our corporate sponsor for this topic is AllumiaX.com from Seattle, Washington. Contact them for industrial and commercial power system studies. Now let us continue where we left off in the previous part in part 3b. In the bonus step, we will calculate the voltage quantities. Now in the previous section for part 3b, we calculated the phase current quantities for a single line to ground fault on the 13.8 kV system. Now this is the bonus step. In this step, we will calculate the phase voltage quantities at the point of the fault on the 13.8 kV system. And we do that with a very, very similar process, right? And what we will do first is we will go back to our fault to sequence network and redraw it again. In this figure, we want to focus on the positive, negative, and zero sequence voltages that are shown on the low voltage 13.8 kV fictitious bus on the positive negative zero sequence network. And we want to determine the sequence voltage quantities by hand, and from the sequence voltage quantities we will calculate the actual phase voltage quantities. So this is our objective in this section. Now before we move forward, let's first decide on a base value of voltage for our calculation. And because the voltage at the point of the fault is 13.8 kV, we will select that as our base value below, which is V base is equal to 13.8 kV divided by root 3. Now to calculate the positive sequence voltage, we will now apply KVL in the positive sequence loop. So here we go. The positive sequence voltage will equal the sum of the voltages across the voltage source minus the voltage drop due to the positive sequence impedance. That is 1∠0 minus J.15, which is the sum of the positive sequence generator and the transformer impedance, multiplied by the per unit positive sequence current that is flowing to the 13.8 kV fictitious bus, which is negative J2.5 per unit. The negative J2.5 per unit was calculated in the previous part 3b section. That gives us 0.625 per unit. Now it needs to be converted to the actual voltage quantities by multiplying with the base value of 13.8 kV divided by square root of 3. So that gives us 4.98 kV at the angle of 0 degrees. Similarly, now that we've calculated the positive sequence voltage quantity, now we will calculate the negative sequence voltage quantity. Similarly, we will apply KVL again in the negative sequence and zero sequence networks to calculate the per unit voltage and then multiply by the voltage base to get the actual voltage quantities. Since there is no voltage source in the negative sequence loop, it will be considered zero. So the negative sequence voltage is equal to zero minus J.15 per unit, which is the transformer and generator impedance, times negative J2.5, which is the current that's going to the 13.8 kV fictitious bus, negative sequence. That is equal to negative 0.375 per unit. Okay, in terms of the actual voltage quantities, that's equal to 2.988 kV at the angle of 180 degrees. And that voltage will entirely consist of the voltage drop across the negative sequence impedance, that is J.15 per unit times negative J2.5. Again, that gives us negative 0.375 per unit. And we multiply it accordingly to determine the 2.988 kV at the angle of 180 degrees. This is the negative sequence voltage. For zero sequence voltage, we do the following. The zero sequence voltage is equal to zero minus J.10 times negative J2.5, which is equal to negative J2.5 per unit. Here, the impedances will be negative J.10 only because the transformer per unit impedance is only considered, and the generator impedance, which is J.05, must be excluded from the loop due to the open delta, and we already know that the zero sequence current will not flow through the high voltage side, which strengthened this point even more. Furthermore, like the negative sequence, we don't have a voltage source for the zero sequence. That is why the voltage source equals zero, and again, we get negative 0.25 per unit for the zero sequence voltage quantity. And then we multiply that with our base to get 1.992 kV at 180 degrees. That's the zero sequence voltage quantity. Now, so we've calculated the positive sequence voltage quantity, the negative sequence voltage quantity, and the zero sequence voltage quantity. Now let us determine, using our familiar transformation equations, to get the phase voltage quantities at the point of the fault on the 13.8 kV bus. Plugging in these calculated values of the three sequence components and the A operator, here's what we get. Solving the math with a scientific calculator will lead us to the following answers. The voltage at the point of the fault on phase A is equal to 0 kV. The voltage at the point of the fault on phase B is equal to 7.52 kV at the angle of negative 113 degrees. The voltage at the point of the fault on phase C will equal 7.52 kV at the angle of 113 degrees. This is an interesting result. Now let's redraw the original drawing and let's talk about this. This is an interesting and very logical and intuitive result because we know that the fault was a one line to ground fault on phase A. Now, at the point of the fault, it's very clear that phase A voltage will drive to zero, and which is something that's very common and that is something that we should totally expect. However, phase B and phase C voltage magnitudes will have a slight depression in voltage. During normal and balanced operating condition, we should expect phase voltages to be 13.8 kV divided by square root of 3, which equals 7.96 kV. However, during phase A to ground fault, at the point of the fault, phase B and C voltages are 7.52 kV, which is interesting because it's a slight depression on the unfaulted phases. Another interesting thing to note is that the angle of phase B and C voltages are opposite. They're equal in magnitude, but the angles are opposite, which makes sense because phase A voltage is driven to zero. And again, at the point of the fault, the remaining two phases will need to balance out. So the phase voltages are going to be equal, but the angles are going to be opposite. Now, in the next video, we will walk through a similar calculation for the line-to-line fault. Now, we hope that you find this video tutorial valuable and useful as a professional or a student. Please support us by becoming our patron and donating through patreon.com/generalpack. Your generous donation will help us continue making high-quality power system video tutorials. Thank you.